Okay, welcome to another open course, another meeting with One Horse Life, how to dramatically improve your horse training skills. Under this humble title, we have for you prepared very, very hardcore lectures about hardcore skills that we see personally with Pawel as essentials for all horse trainers and horse owners who dream about dramatically making like this dramatic change, like stepping up a totally different level in their horsemanship. So today we are going to speak about effective leadership, and I give mic back to Pawel.
Thank you, Anna. So just to recapitulate for all of you who maybe didn't listen to our last meeting, or maybe you want to refresh your memory, we have two types of methods, two type of tools which you can find in horsemanship or generally in your life. The one type is proactive, and these tools are mainly to build something. They answer the question, what do I have today? How can I build on top on it? And we have reactive tools, which are answering the question, what is wrong? How can I fix it? And we've been discussing it in a very detailed form last time, and we had many examples, and you could see that most of the time when people think about horsemanship, most of the books, actually all the books I've seen in my life about horsemanship, they are about reactive tools and reactive thinking. Why is it like this? The reason is lack of leadership. Because when there is lack of leadership, then everything goes wrong and what you can do is only react. This is the very simple fact. If you are in the company without a leader, then everything goes wrong, and the only thing that you can do is putting down fires which are all around the company. And I was running many companies in my life. I know it. I was learning this stuff hard way, because most of the advices that you can find are simply not practical and unusable. So whenever you see that there is a need for reactive tools in a more intensified way, in a bigger frequency, then you immediately know that in this situation is lack of leadership. There is lack of leader who will be building the situation using proactive tools and leading the situation to some better future. When there is not happening, then you have more and more things to fix, and everyone is focused on fixing, and people are asking only questions, how can I fix this, how can I fix that, and they are receiving answers only in this genre. Oh, you can fix it like this, or you can fix it like that, you can fix it using this method, you can fix it using that method. And no one is really telling these people, take a step back, look at your situation and look how you can build starting from this situation, and look how you can build the situation in a way that you don't have these problems in the future. And this is leadership. Leadership is about taking some situation from the place that is in the current moment and taking into the future to make it the situation that we want. And this is important to understand it like this. I will be telling you later why. Many people, and this is what Anna was saying, that we will be not talking about horses, because many people, when they talk about leadership in the context of horses, they think about how can I boss around my horse and call it leadership. In my eyes, as more than 30 years of experience in leading people and many companies, I can tell you honestly that these methods and this thinking has no application for horses. So I wouldn't be applying any management or leadership skills to horses generally, because it is a different world, different situation, and we need other skills, other methods. And we cannot just say that, okay, my horse is my situation, I will be leading my horse to do this or do that. So just to close this topic, that we will be not talking about this. We will be not talking about leadership as a way to bossing around the horse and say, oh, these are my leadership skills. So where the leadership is important? We've been discussing some examples with Anna before we met. So I like
before we met with you, not before.
Yes, before we met today with you. And let me discuss these examples with you now, so we will be seeing it better. So first example that we have is horse is not moving forward, and how we can react to this. And you see, I already used the word react because we already focus on the problem. But even looking in how we deal with this problem, you can see if you have a leader in front of you or you have someone that is only waiting to react and only knowing the reactions. So usually we do something like lesson of the legs, we've been discussing last time, or other pressure release methods, which are making the situation better for a moment and worse in the bigger perspective. And this is a situation that shows that when we think about leadership, even when we think about examples of leadership, we think about really what we think about is crisis management. I was discussing it with Anna before, what are the situations when you really need a strong leadership? And we found examples like horse is sick and we need to act quickly, find a good vet and maintain good care of this horse, or there is a problem with the horse, maybe the horse is not giving legs and the trimmer is coming and we need to do something, we need to make decisions. So you see, one of the functions of the leader is making crisis management. But if a leader is good only in crisis management, which is important, I'm not saying it is not important, but if the leader is only good in crisis management, then it is not a good leader. Because then we know that this person who is responsible for the situation is allowing the situations to happen. Of course, we cannot make it free from crises. We cannot make the situation of training or having a horse free 100% from crises. We will have crises, we will have health crises, we will have some situations which are unexpected. And good crisis management is very important in good leadership, but it cannot be constant crisis management. You cannot lead her through managing crises. You cannot lead her.
Very much happening, isn't it?
Yes, because crises are very visible, like these reactive tools. They are very visible. They are like magic, you know, that horse was not moving and it's not moving. And it's now it's moving. Horse was not giving legs and now is some magical thing happened and now it's giving the legs. But it shows lack of leadership in the bigger perspective. It's like a horse is not coming to the trailer, and now someone comes and shows you some magic method of putting this horse to the trailer. But where was this leader before when it was time to prepare this horse to coming to the trailer? So this shows lack of leadership. And you know, in the business life, if you have people managing companies or leading companies, which are two different things, then you really measure the quality of the manager or the leader by how many crises this person has. If this person has more than like one crisis every 6 months, then you know that this is not a good person.
This is very interesting, yes. Because usually in horsemanship you can see that very popular are the trainers that usually specialize in managing crises, like the horse is backing, give it to this trainer. There is like lack of appreciation in an eventful life that is like slow progression, steady progression, that is a sign of effective leadership.
Exactly. Sign of effective leadership is that you are not receiving any news from such a person. Now I work in this situation that I'm owning the companies and have my managers and leaders in these companies. And if they are not writing to me any urgent emails that need my intervention, then I know that, or attention, then I know that these are right people for this job. And I keep them in this job. If they are writing to me all the time, you know, we have this crisis, that crisis, what would you suggest me to do, what to do with this, what to do with that, then I know that this is not a good person for this job, and probably we need to change this person to another one. Of course, in business and in horsemanship, in all areas of life, managing crisis is very visible and can be seen as some superpowers. That because we see the problem and we see that it is gone. So it makes this false feeling of achievement, this false feeling of success, this false feeling of being powerful. Actually, it is very bad. And if you observe the situation for a longer time, you know that you cannot live like this. You cannot live from crisis to crisis. And in horsemanship, I see many people, they want to live like this. They want to solve crises one by another, and they usually create another crisis on the way, because this is the nature of solving crises using the reactive tools. And then they have another crisis, another crisis, another crisis, and then they deal with these crises. Sometimes they say, okay, we will leave this crisis for now, and maybe in the future it will solve itself, which never happens. Like I heard once, the trainer in the very, very beginning, one of the Anna's trainer told her that don't worry about the contact, later you will be riding on a very strong contact, now we see it. So,
no, not on a strong contact, but on a car beat.
I wanted to avoid this part to not make it sound even worse. But you know this thinking that we will have this problem, we will be carrying this problem, and it can create many crises in the future. But we are like putting it aside, and we don't deal with it.
We have a note from Rachel that says, this is very interesting because we are told that being able to solve issues is a good thing, and seeing quick results is a good thing. Yet it is actually the opposite.
It is a good thing to know how to solve issues. Like, it is a good thing to have a nice neighbor who can fix your car. But it is a bad thing to have a car who needs to be fixed every day. And I think everyone understands it. And there are many jokes about it. You know, I remember that when I bought a very good car, I even didn't know where I put this fluid for the windshield, because I never opened the, or I have problems with opening the mask because I never opened it. So I know that this is a good car. And knowing stuff is generally good, but it is not something that will take you to the bright future. You know, if using this example, if your goal is to ride your car and have this car accessible for you every day, which knowledge would you like to have? How to choose a good car or how to repair a car? Of course, repairing a car is a nice thing to know, if you can really repair your car. But in this case, most important will be for you to know how to choose the car that you will not to have to know how to repair it. And this is one is proactive and another one is reactive. And this shows the difference. And because fixing, repairing is so exciting, we all focus on it. What is less exciting is guiding the situation and leading the situation in a way that you don't have to fix and repair anything. And to give you one example for this, contact with the horse. We had this big discussion several years ago with Anna about all these possible problems with the contact. And then we developed RTRT, and then we see that when you do RTRT, you just don't have these problems. And now people are asking us, for example, what to do with this, what to do with that, my horse is doing this, my horse is doing that. And we say, okay, yes, do RTRT and it will disappear. And people are a little bit like, disappointed. No, but you know, I have this problem. Maybe you should tell me what should I do with this problem. I say, we don't care if your horse is leaning on the bit or not accepting the bit or is moving your head up or is shaking your head or chomping or whatever. This is the solution, because this is proactive solution which leads to the situation that you don't have this problem. And this kind of solutions we like the most, and this kind of solutions show good leadership. So what is good and what is bad leadership? And we will be using life examples from our experience of meeting many people on our way with training horses now to just show you what we are talking
about.
But
maybe I can ask you, Pawel, because I think this is very interesting. Mm-hmm. In horsemanship, usually when we say about leaders, we say that they demand respect, that you have to know how to take respect from your horse or how to make the horse respecting you. Mm-hmm. But in what would you say from your managing career, what are the good character traces, mm-hmm, of a good leader when it comes to running projects or companies for other people?
This is what I wanted to tell now.
Fantastic.
So, but before I can answer this question, we need to really talk even for a short moment what leadership is. So leadership is really three things. I know what I want, I know how to get it, I do it. Mm-hmm. These are these three things. And if you want more fancy words about it, you need to have a goal, you need to have a vision, you need to have a tools, and you need to execute. And then if we talk about good leader, we can look into all this perspective. Do you know what you want? If you don't know what you want, there is no leadership. There is wandering around. Mm-hmm. And this is the first thing that I see many people with horses have, that they don't know what they want.
I will put it down in the comments so people can put it down in their notes. I know what I want. Yes, the second.
The second one is I know how to get it. If you, mm-hmm, are into punk music from 70s, you know from where I am quoting it. And the third one is I do it. Mm-hmm. And these are three things. If you, I know how to get it, you can divide into two things, vision and tools. Like vision is more like constant, but still can change. And tools are something that you use from place to place. Who is a good leader? Because people put many information about this good leader is a man, person, or has this trace of character or that. Some general from the army is talking about leadership from the perspective of putting people, you know, in the fighting situation. Another person leading the companies will be telling this. Me leading from the perspective of the trainer is something else. Some coach from the football team can be telling different things. Some of them can be the same, like you need to be a good person.
Overlap.
Yes, mm-hmm, they can be very, the people think that leaders need to talk very well, like Kennedy was good in talking. They need to inspire people or they need to write very well. All the skills are very nice, but they are absolutely not important. Believe me, what is important is to do these three things. I know what I want, I know how to get it, I do it. If you don't know what you want, you have to spend some time and get to know what you want. So this is first thing. This is first task for you. This is your first homework. If you don't know what you want with your horses, because this is the context of our meeting, if you don't know what you want with your horsemanship life, and I'm not talking about learning and improving your skills because this is obvious. I'm talking about if you have a horse, you need to know what you want to do with this horse. As simple as this. If you don't know it, there is no leadership. There is just wandering around. There is nothing wrong in wandering around, but then you will have results that are
typical for
wandering around. You will be wandering around something which probably will lead you to nowhere. Second thing is I know how to get it. And this is where people are spending most time. they learn or they make these false superstitions that good leader needs to be a good person, or he needs to know how to inspire other people, etc., etc. Believe me, it's not like this. And usually people put such qualities on the people that achieved something, and they believe that they were a good person. I don't know, example from the top of my head.
But with the horses, I think that it is knowledge about tools that are that will take you where you want to get. And I think that here the maze starts, because sometimes the tools that we want to use will not get us to the picture that we have in mind, because on the way we lost that picture. So I think that, you know, when your horse is not moving forward, of course, how to get it can be to kick him, but it is not aligned with the dream about freely moving and willingly moving horse that you had at the beginning. So I know that this central part is very problematic, because here emotions appear, many emotions appear, and people are losing from the side the initial goal. Like, I know what I want. So here usually the emotions a little bit can change the tools, and the tools are shaping the final effect.
Yes.
Yes.
Anna, because you are taking everything I wanted to say.
Really? I'm brilliant.
I don't know what to say now. Okay, no. But what is important? What is, because you asked who is a good leader. Good leader is someone who will not stop before he has answers to these questions. And this is the only quality of the good leader. If I don't know what I want, I need to answer this question. Then if I don't know how to get it, I need to find answer to this question. If I don't have answer to this question, then I'm looking for the answer to this question. I will be looking for the answer to this question as long as it's needed, and I will be searching, I will be trying, I will be persistent, I will be trying this, I will be trying that, and then I will get the answer, and then I will do this. And then the most important part, I do it. And this is where most people fail. So you can fail in three places as a leader. You can fail because you don't know what you want. Or if you are hired leader, you don't know what other people want from you. So you need to ask them. It's easier because they will tell you, we want you to do this or that. Second thing, maybe you don't know how to get it. And it is very common. And don't think that leaders know answers for all the questions. Maybe they seem like this, maybe, but it's always post-mortem. It's like we have all these discussions with Anna many times, that people sit down after some situation and they analyze what we did, and then they try to make a big knowledge from it. But it is always analyzing something that already happened, and we've been in the situation, and now we know that it went very well. But it doesn't mean that we've found anything important, or we found any kind of important knowledge in it. It just means that in this particular situation it worked. And this is very big problem, that people believe that if something worked in this situation, it worked in other situation. And they just need to learn more, and they just need to have more tools. And the third place that you can fail, and this is the most common one I see around me, is that people don't do it. And this is the worst one in my eyes. And this is the worst leadership. Because if you know what you want, if you know how to get it, and you are not doing it, then it is the worst. Then it is really something that shouldn't be happening. Because maybe there is a problem with articulating what I want. And you don't have to be too scientific about it. It is just simple things are the best in this place. Maybe I really don't know how to get it. But if I know how to get it and I don't do it, then there is no excuse. And there is one thing that glues all of this. And this is something that is really, really needed. And it is called responsibility. And we've been discussing it with Anna, why so many times we see people that they know what they want. They want a beautiful, healthy horse who is moving freely through the body and being friendly and open for humans and other horses, for example. They know how to get it because maybe they follow us and they see all these relaxation-based methods and they really strongly believe that it is something that can work for the horse, but they still don't do it. And there is a very visible lack of taking responsibility, which is extremely common. And it is very common in horsemanship. In horsemanship, most of the time, people have the attitude, I will be doing exactly what other people are doing, other people around me. And if I fail, then, you know, it's not a big deal because everyone can fail, but no one will tell me, oh, you made the wrong decision. So it is like guiding or leading without making any decisions.
Mm-hmm. It is hiding behind the shared responsibility yes. of the group.
Yes.
But at the end of the day, it's us who are responsible for every individual horse is responsible yes. his owner.
I don't want to sound too dramatic, but at the end, someone will be suffering and it will be probably the horse. So important thing is that if you decide to have a horse, then you become a leader and not a leader in the sense that you will be guiding your horse to walk between some cones, but in the sense that you will be guiding this horse and you like a joint situation for the whole life.
Mm-hmm.
If you are interested, it is why One Horse Life is named One Horse Life, because horse has only one life with you. You can have many horses, you can change them, you can switch them, but your horse has only one owner, you, and has only one life with you. So it is good to be a responsible person and to understand your role in this situation, and your role is not to be a mother, father, or a friend, or another horse in the herd of the horses or something like this. Your role is to become a leader of this situation. And it is important to understand that you are leader of the situation, not the leader of your horse or not the leader of yourself, because you are leading situation always. Why is it important to understand? And this is something that Anna already said, that most of the time when it comes to making decisions, which is part of leadership, how we make the decisions, we internalize the problem, we start thinking that this is our problem. My horse is not moving, my horse is not giving legs, my horse is not respecting me, my horse is crazy or something, or spooky. And then we internalize it, and then we, starting from these emotions and from internalizing it, we make decision to satisfy something. So what we can try to satisfy? First of all, we can try to satisfy ourselves, which is the most common case. If someone sits on the horse and the horse is not moving forward, then what we hear, what people say about it? Usually it is something like, my horse is not respecting my aids. You see, how dares this horse not to respect aids of such a wonderful, fantastic rider? And then I need to do something, and then I do something, which is usually some variation of the lessons of the lesson of the legs. And what is the real purpose of this lesson of the legs? The real purpose of this lesson of the legs is to satisfy my need to feel better. I want you to think a little bit about it. To satisfy my need to feel better. And now question for you. Would it be better if this person would be thinking to satisfy horse to feel better or not? Should good leader be thinking about satisfying himself to feel better or horse to feel better? I'm giving you some time to think about it.
And how do you think? You can share your thoughts in the chat. Janine says always horse. Mm-hmm. Rachel asks in the meantime, what about confidence? I feel like I lack confidence in certain situations.
Confidence is not important for leadership at all. I had my first company when I was 20 years old, and believe me, 90% of the people working for me were older than me, smarter than me, knew more. And I was walking and looking at them, but I was the only one who knew what I want. The only one. And I learned very quickly that people will be telling you all the time what they think you should be wanting, but it is not what you want. And I learned very quickly that I need to be a leader and I need to really tell these people what I want. And I had to learn how to talk to them, how to get what I want from this situation, how to lead this situation, because otherwise everyone is pulling a little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit here, a little bit there. I had no confidence at all, because from where I could take it, you know, it was like I was a young guy and surrounded by older people with a lot of experience. But it is not important at all. What is important is remember about the sufferings. I know what I want, I know how to get it, I do it. If you don't have one of these, you are in a very big trouble. And now we have answers. And
the horse.
So what would be the solution or the answer from the leader who thinks that he needs to satisfy the horse in this situation?
We have interesting answer. Frederica says, I believe feeling good is important for the horse and myself.
Yes, it is another way of thinking. And another wrong way of thinking, because it leads to the wrong decisions. And this is the mistake that most of the people do. Sorry for putting you on the mind here, because I knew that you will answer the horse, which is a normal answer and a very good one, and showing that you care a lot about your horses. But from the leadership perspective, it is a very wrong answer, because the role of the leader is not to satisfy the leader or not to satisfy the horse or not to satisfy anyone else. It is to lead. So to change the situation into direction that you want the situation to be changed. And this is very important to know, that we are not there to satisfy anyone. Neither you, neither other parties, neither... This is the biggest mistake that people put in all of the books I've seen about leadership, that you need to satisfy these people and that people. It's wrong. It's completely unnecessary. What you need to do is to think how to move situation from this place to another place and to be closer to the situation you want. Just to show you, I will be giving you questions that will guide you to understand what this crazy person is telling me now. If you have a kid, and this kid has a bad tooth, and what do you want to do with this kid? Do you go to the dentist or not? Just to give you these choices. Because this kid maybe not be very happy if you will go with this kid to dentist. You see? I will be not even asking you to answer this question, because if you are a mom of the kid and you are the leader of the situation, and in your goals is I want to have a healthy kid, you are not really thinking if my kid wants to go to the dentist or not. It's not even in your...
Or the opposite situation, yes. We can have, like the kid has maybe crooked teeth, mm-hmm. And the mom wants to satisfy her fear of spending money, of, you know, not wanting to spend money, and she is not taking the kid to the orthodontist, even if the kid would love it, yes. And asks for that. We have a question, Pawel. Yes. Can the answer to the part, I know how to get it, be to find someone to help?
Absolutely. This is the best answer. This is the best answer. And just to stop my kid's story for a moment and answer this question to the fullness, but you all the time need to remember what you want. So if you see that this person is realizing something else that you, then it is different, that something that you want, then you immediately have to find another solution. And this is very, very typical situation. And
however, I have to add here, sometimes where you want to be is not directly linked to the road that you have to go through. Because many times I get owners that want their horses to move superly through the body or stop panic attacks. And we start from walking the horse, doing relaxation technique. And they say, yeah, but I don't have problems walking with my horse. My problem starts at the competition or when I mount my horse or when I travel with my horse in the trailer. Yes. So you have to also find someone who will like know the dream that you want to have and will show you the steps to get there. Because many times, if you don't know how to get to this dream, it means also that you don't know the links, the stepping stones.
Yes. Yes. In horsemanship, it is very easy to see because most of the time people who are supposed to do some job in a way that you want them to do, they do the opposite. So it's not very subtle, it's very visible. And then we do not take actions because of what I'm discussing with you now, because we have this need to satisfy others. And believe me, good leadership is about not satisfying anyone. Absolutely, you don't think about satisfying anyone, and then you become good leader. You are satisfying only your goal, only what you want to have. Maybe it sounds bad. Sorry. Maybe it is not what you expected to hear. Sorry, but this is something that is important to know, because only then you will know how to make good decisions. So let's get back for a moment to this kid. It's obvious that mom will be not asking, how are you feeling about going to the dentist? Or how now in horsemanship people like to measure cortisol level. And then they come to the conclusion, I don't know, kids have elevated cortisol level horses. In dentist. No, kids have elevated cortisol levels in dentist. So maybe we shouldn't be taking them there because, you know, they obviously suffer and it's not a good way of taking care of the kid. Am I exaggerating a little bit? But now listen what you can do with it. Should mother send kid to the school? Maybe not, because kids have elevated cortisol level at schools. So it's obviously not good for them. And if you look in the horsemanship discussions now, people like to use cortisol level as a final like truth about shall we do something with horses or not. So maybe we should use the same with kids and say schools are bad because kids have elevated cortisol level at school and it is very bad. And many times people comment something that horses shouldn't be ridden or horses shouldn't be this or that because they are stressed or they feel this, they feel that. I feel also that kids shouldn't be going to the school because they are stressed at school. And it all depends on what is your goal. You know, I strongly believe that horses should be taught everything. They should be skillful, healthy, and know a lot of stuff, and then they will have better life. Even if something happens, it will be better for them to move to another place. Like with kids, they will be doing better in their lives without parents when they learn something at school. But all depends of what are your goals, what you want to achieve. But coming back to this lesson of the legs, a question. It was very tricky because I a little bit manipulated you to come to the mind because, first of all, we know that satisfying the ego or satisfying how feels the rider is bad, and then maybe we should satisfy the horse bad, maybe we should satisfy the owner of the horse bad, maybe we should satisfy the audience bad, maybe we should satisfy the judges bad. What you should be satisfying is what you want to achieve. That's all. If you want to have a healthy, relaxed, good moving horse, you are asking yourself a question. I know what I want. Now I need to know how to get it, and then I do it. And it is not about satisfying anyone. And this is very, very important to know, because if you will be in the satisfying mode, you will be making bad decisions. And what is even more probable, you will be making decisions, you will be not making decisions at all. And I remember Anna already said it, I don't know, in our last meeting or in other meeting about this, I think on Anna's meeting, that we have watched this show on Netflix about the guy who was going with the group of other guys through Alaska, and they were supposed to get from one point to another, one place to another, and this guy knew that they should go left, but all the group wanted to go right, and he did nothing. He just went with all the group, being like 100% sure that in the end he will get all the points because it was all recorded, and he clearly said we should go left, and the group said no, we should go right, and then he went with the group, and then this guide came, this guy from Alaska, and said I'm taking all your points, and maybe you should pack and go home, because if you know where to go and you don't tell people that they should go with you, and you go with them even, this is very, very bad.
And you cannot convince them to follow you. You did
nothing. You just went with them, believing that it is enough to know where it is, where it goes. Why it happened? Because he wanted to satisfy them. He probably was thinking,
or he was afraid of responsibility.
Afraid of responsibility, of failure. Also, probably he was thinking, I will start fighting with them and they will be not happy, so maybe I will not do it.
We have interesting Pawel inputs on the chat. So someone using Galaxy smartphone says, cortisol is okay as we have mechanisms to cope with. Prolonged cortisol is bad, so living is constant stress.
Yes, of course. I'm not arguing now about cortisol, good or bad. I'm arguing now that you cannot use it as an input for the discussion what you should do with your horse or with your life. Because you can very quickly put it into absurd situation that people will be arguing that you shouldn't send kids to the school because we can very quickly measure their cortisol level and it's too high, too high.
And then Patty says, really interesting relationship between horse owner and trainer. Mm. Both have leadership roles, but owner must demonstrate leadership in choosing trainer, then switch to following a trusted leader.
Yes, this is like like higher level of leadership because you need to know how to work with leaders. And if it becomes your profession, for example, you buy horses and you give them to training and you expect some results, then you really need to be professional in choosing these trainers and managing them and telling them what you want. But this is delegation of responsibility. It is so easy that you delegate some responsibility, like the whole package. But the delegation of responsibility starts from what? Starts from telling, I know what I want. If there is no such point that you know what you want and you delegate it, then who knows what you want? Then they will start from what they want and then they will be doing what they want to do. So for example,
but I think this is most of the cases with horses given to the training that people are a little bit later disappointed that they don't have the horse that they had in mind. Mm-hmm. But they didn't tell the trainer, or they chose the trainer incorrectly, and the trainer was just following what they want and choosing the methods to achieve it.
And in the end, they blame the horse. The horse is not good enough. Please take your horse and bring me another one because this one is not good enough for my fantastic training methods. So delegation of responsibility is also a very simple process. You start from finding someone who you know that can do the job. How you can know it? You know, from seeing or looking into previous jobs done by this person. And you should be really looking for someone who is as close to what you want to achieve as is possible. Then you say, I want this. And then you ask, how do you plan to achieve it for me? And usually, if you omit this discussion, then, you know, people do whatever they want with your horses. And then there are many, many, many decisions on the way, like a very simple decision from OPP program, Optimal Performance Program, that we do a lot of walking in the beginning. It can take even 2 months that there is walking. And other people start interfering with this. They come to the owner or trainer and say, I see that your horse is only walking. I think that your horse should be also trotting and cantering because it is unhealthy only to walk. I see that your horse is getting weight or maybe you have joint problems, etc., etc.
No, joint problems, no. You're making it up now. Yeah, multiplying up, problems.
But it is like building fear in this person. And now imagine that someone who is responsible for making this decision, like the horse owner or trainer, is not really rooted in, I know what I want, I know how to get it, I'm doing it. And it's like thinking, oh my God, maybe this is true. Maybe I should be also chasing my horse with the whip for at least 1 hour a day. And then people do it or do it even secretly, not telling us. And then, of course, it interferes with the OPP program. And then no one is responsible for the results because there is no power who is really taking care of keeping things on track. And this is what leaders are doing. They are providing this power of taking care that things are on track all the time. And of course, you can be wrong many times, but you are all the time responsible. And if you make this deal that I listen to this person and I do what this person is telling me because I don't want to be responsible, then you stop being a leader. And then you have to look around and to ask yourself a question. Okay, so who is the leader now? Because if there is no leader, there will be a problem. And probably someone will be suffering. And probably it will be a horse. So you need to know such things. And sorry for being a little bit dramatic. And I'm talking about suffering of the horse a lot. But it is the truth. You know, if there are no leaders around the horses, if there are no people who are leading the situation to some good place that you want to have, then its situation is drifting, and when something is drifting, it's probably drifting in the wrong places. We have a question now?
Yes, we have. From Susanna. Mm-hmm. How do you handle a situation when you would like to tell someone that a special tool might help their situation, but they have not asked you directly? Then I often do not say something because I want them to be open. But on the other hand, I might give them a seat for something new. What is your thinking on this?
We never talk to the people who are not asking us about things. I personally never do this.
So there is this rule, if I can say, there are these three questions that I always ask myself. Is that, am I asked for help? Yeah, so I will put it down. So mm-hmm. You may also use it. So am I asked for help? So this is the first. Is someone coming and asking me, hey, either as a friend or as a trainer or as a fellow trainer or your coach, yes? Mm-hmm. Anna, help me, yes? Am I asked for help? So maybe not. Maybe I don't have to. This is like the first like doors that have to be open for you to carry on. Then is can I help? And this is more like I here in this second question, I always ask myself, can I help? But not in a way that do I have time or can I? But more, is this like help is going to lead in a good direction? Because the most of the problems are happening when people share with other people the so-called unjustified help. You know, some people just should not be helped, but not in a way that they don't deserve it or something like that, but this is their lesson. They made, you know, such a mess with their life, and they blame the horse that now it's their responsibility to undo the knots. And usually people with the biggest problems are also the ones that blame others for their misfortune and for their lack of success and for their horse's problems the most. So you have to ask yourself, can I help? Is this situation safe for you, for your life, for your career? Can you help? Is this situation also safe for you? Yes? And then the last, because if the second door is open, if you see that the person doesn't have a lot of negativity in their life, you know how to check it. Well, I can check it. There are like tools that you can check it. What is the negativity level inside of the person? If you are not very intuitive person, you can also like listen for a moment to this person. How does she speak about other people who tried to help her before? How is she speaking about friends or other trainers who invested their time, their life, their knowledge in solving this situation? If there is like a lot of bashing other people, a lot of trashing other methods, I would say don't go there, because you will become one of them. This person is not yet ready to receive the help. Yes? Mm-hmm. And then the last question is, do I know how to help? And here is like, honestly, you have to look at your skills, at your level of knowledge, because many times, you know, this is the when the two first doors are open, usually maybe here you don't have the right skills. Maybe it's better to direct this person to a fellow trainer. Maybe you don't have the skills to ride crazy backing youngsters. Maybe it will not be good for you. Maybe you will not be able to carry this situation from A to Z. Maybe it's better to direct to someone more skillful or just more experienced in this area. So these are the three questions that the doors have to be opened for you to help. So first is, am I asked for help? At all? Are you asked to help? Then is, can I help? Does this person deserves help? What is the negativity level in this person? Will you expose yourself to be another person to be blamed for lack of success? Or is this person like understanding that she or he led this situation? She was a bad leader. She led this situation to be in the point where it is right now. And then if there is, these two gates are open, you have to honestly ask yourself, do I know how to help? Do I have the right skills? Do I have the experience? Do I know the A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and all the steps are to right up to Z, that you know how to lead this situation? And if not, don't do that, because then the horse will suffer. Lose trust of a person that can become your very well trusted friend if the situation is developing well. Okay, and then Patty Pavel has a question. Delegation of responsibility. Perfect, thank you.
Yes.
And then Ines says, maybe the person doesn't, but you see that the horse would enjoy some help.
Yes, but let me get you on tracks here and being a leader for a moment of this discussion and this group. You see, this is also very very interesting fact that we prefer talking about others, we prefer talking about helping others, and this is not leadership at all. You should be focused on your goals, your horses, your families, your situation, and what you can do with this. And when others will come and tell you, okay, I want your help or I need your help, then you are there and you are supporting them. And believe me, we've been staying in many stables in our lives, showing fantastic results with our horses. It is quite rare that people are coming and asking us.
This is good. I think that also it works both. directions, because trust me, you know, to help you need to, you need that someone to be open and you need to know what is really happening. Sometimes you just look for 5 minutes and you think that you know what is happening. It's not true. And vice versa, we also, our students were also reporting that they were just doing relaxation technique with their horse and they had many helpers coming and saying, oh, are you riding this horse? Will you ever ride this horse? That's do you need help with that? You know, because I see that you are just walking, and they didn't need any help, they didn't ask for any help. So I also think that, you know, going through these three questions that I said about, and adding on top of that what Pawel said, staying focused on your life, your path, don't not using other people as a distraction, you know, from not tuning to your sheet and carrying it, you know, from A to Z, is also a way to avoid leadership in your garden.
Yes, but this meeting is not about helping others. It's not.
This is what I just said.
Yes.
So you can calm down.
I'm calming down myself now. It is about helping you to become better leaders in your situations, because we want to dramatically improve your horse training skills.
So not dramatically improve other people's results.
So I was preparing this program and I was thinking, what is important, how you can dramatically improve your horse training skills, even in the situation, in the context that you are training your horses. So you are not a professional trainer, you are not doing it for money to other people's horses, you just train your horses. And the first thing was understanding proactive and reactive tools. And second thing, understanding leadership and understanding that if you even are the owner of a horse, and this is even one horse, you are already leader of the situation. You can be good leader, you can be bad leader. We have in our stables horses which are totally abandoned, and the owner of the place is so nice that he keeps them and feeds them. But you know, this is very bad leadership, abandoning, obviously. And we have people who do some work with these horses every day. And we know how to do our work every day. And I'm sharing this with you because I know that this will help you dramatically. So what is the first step of becoming a leader? It is taking responsibility. That you are taking responsibility for what? You are taking responsibility for the situation. You are not responsible for you being happy, or for your horse being happy, or for owner being happy, or other people being happy. You are responsible for this situation, and you are responsible for moving the situation into the direction that is your goal. So you need to take responsibility for this, and you need to know what you want. So first thing that you can do, and I strongly suggest you to do, is to write down what I want. Honestly, and the shorter it is, the better it is. At some point, people have so many problems with their horses that what they want is, I want my horse to be healthy, or I want my horse to not be so spooky. But,
or I want my horse to be happy.
Or I want my horse to be happy, or which is actually very, very bad goal, because you don't know if your horse is happy or not. Can you make your horse happy? I wouldn't be having such goals. But even having goal, I want my horse to be healthy, is good starting point. But you need to know what you want. This is very, very, very important. And sometimes people say, I have my horse because I want to learn. I have my horse because I decided to learn riding, or I wanted to learn different methods of horsemanship. It is fantastic, but this will guide you to the wrong places. Because first you need to know what you want, and then you can start looking into different methods and tools. And this process will never end. You will be always learning, you will be always looking in different methods and tools. There is no final decision, this is what I want to do in my life and I stick with it. But if you start from this, you are starting from the middle. And then you have no no ground to, you have no tools to see if you are getting closer to what you want or you are getting farther from what you want, which is very bad because you are wandering around. And this is unfortunately what we see, and people give wandering around advices. And I see posts like this that someone is asking, my trainer told me to do this, what do you think about it? And 50 people write, change the trainer. And I'm reading it and I say, what is the base of this advices? And I read advice after advice after advice after advice, change the trainer, change the trainer, change the trainer. And then I understand that it was very emotional post about someone being unhappy with the situation, and people like emotionally connect with it, and they want to satisfy these emotions, and they say change the trainer because they think that this will help the situation. But what situation? There is no description of the situation. There is no description of what we want to achieve. Maybe it is the best trainer that can support this person now. So, of course, asking questions on social media and receiving so-called advices is a very big and separate topic, but this shows a little bit how people think, that they want to satisfy some fluctuating emotions of me or for other people or imaginary emotions of my horse, and then because they are fluctuating very quickly, we make very emotional quick decisions, which are never finished and which guide us nowhere, because we don't have this anchor which tells us where we want to go. So this is the first thing, and this is what we want to know, and this is what is very important, and this is the first step. You need to take a piece of paper, you need to take pen and write down what you want. You can change it, don't worry. You can come next week or next month and you can write something else. But you need to have it. If you don't have it, then you are just wandering around. And if you think that your horses don't like being ridden, remember that kids don't like going to school. And
Pawel, carry on, because yeah. It's already 1 hour.
Yeah, already 1 hour.
Yeah, you need to...
Okay.
You promised me, because then I cannot attach video to our... lectures, and you have only sound from your presentations.
Okay. Another thing is you need to know how to get it. And this is very, very important. And this will be consuming most of your time, getting to know how to get it. But when you have answer that looks reasonable for you and you believe that this is a good answer, you should immediately doing it. And there is no excuse, there is no really okay, there is no excuse simply to not doing it. And this is the worst situation, that you are in the bad situation, you know what to do, or you are in some situation, you know what you should be doing, and you are not doing it. This is the worst of the all possible situations. So how to improve your leadership skills? First, you need to know what you want. This is what I said already. Then, if you are in the any situation that you need to make decision, there is a very simple tool that can take you to the next level. Before you take decision, write down 3 sentences about the situation, but write down, not only in your head, write down 3 sentences about the situation. What the description of the situation? What do you know about the situation? And look into these sentences. Are these sentences about the situation, or are these sentences about you or other people or imaginary actors of the situation? Because you need to know about the situation. And then looking at the situation, coming back to what you want, you can make decision that will be supporting you in this current moment. And of course, it is not only about crisis management. It is very good in crisis management, because then you really make a good decision very quickly. But it is also very good in planning in the long run, when you make plans, how I want to train my horses for the next 3 months, or maybe for the next year, maybe for the next 2 years. And then you need to know what is the situation, you need to know what you want to achieve, and then you look into it, and then you make a decision.
Okay, perfect. We have a question from Rachel. I would get comments about not riding a horse when they are not ready. Even now with my current horses, it almost makes you feel weak or like you don't know what you are doing. But this discussion helps quite a bit. As long as we just follow our goal and worry about achieving that, then it doesn't matter what anyone else says.
Exactly. If your goal of having a horse is to ride your horse, if you write down what I want to ride my horse. Perfect. And now you see your current situation. Horse is not ready. So of course you don't sit on this horse and start riding, because then you push yourself into the zone of problems, and then you will be spending your whole life in dealing with these problems and doing all the reactive riding. And this is very typical, very usual in horsemanship. Mm-hmm. Sitting on the horse who is too young, not prepared, mm-hmm. not having muscles, not being psychologically ready, and then spending next 15 years of the life of the horse on solving problems that we created the previous day. So you need to, if you know that this is what you want, you need to go through the phase how to get there, how to get it. And this phase is very interesting, because then you learn about how to prepare your horse for riding. And this is what we teach people.
So then I promised Anna to answer her question. She asked earlier, what can you do as a rider to make the horse happy about the ride, not to complicate things? So Anna, if your goal is to make your horse happy when you ride him, if this is your goal, you have to start from knowing your horse and knowing what he likes. Maybe he likes to be ridden to the forest. Maybe he likes cavaletti. Maybe he enjoys jumping. Maybe he enjoys this and that. However, if you ask a little bit deeper, like you want your horse to gain his happiness, not from what he does, but how it is done, that it improves his health, it improves his body, it improves the way he is able to use his body. And for horses, I feel this is very important, because a lot of their self is expression is going through their bodies, is expressed through their bodies. I would say that doing your training in a meaningful way, using the methods, using the I know how to get it, that it's not only providing you result, but also enriching your horse's life a lot, like all the techniques that we use in One Horse Life, optimal performance program, residual tensions, release with the beat. These are the techniques that are made in such a way that they take us closer to the rider's goal of beautiful contact or calm and happy horse. Pawel, yes?
Yes.
And they also... And most importantly, also, I feel like for me, this is very important, that they are designed in such a way that they provide a lot of support for your horse to move better, to feel better, to build his body in a way that he can express himself better through his body. So this is very interesting question that we can address both superficially, and then we just like our focus on that the horse is, you know, enjoying because he goes to the forest, or the horse is just enjoying because he can jump through little jumps, or maybe he enjoys being ridden I don't know, in the arena in a playful way that you give him many, many treats very often. But this is just superficial level, and that this doesn't satisfy our deeper needs, both for horses and humans, for a very long time. The deeper needs is to better understand the world, and this always happens by releasing tensions. Other needs are, what are, Pawel, other needs?
Other needs?
Mm-hmm.
There are many needs, and I want
no, to... No. I want to better understand the world. I want to be able to better use my body. I want to be more healthy. These are shared, very, very common, deeper desires that are very... like shared between all horses and all humans. No one wants not to be healthier. No one wants to not use their bodies in a better way. no one wants not to understand themselves better. So,
you know, if I can comment on it,
important.
This is very difficult topic. Because when we, for example, when we look into horse sports,
I disagree because we are making it, Pawel, very simple in all our classes, and we are achieving it.
Yes,
with many horses.
I'm not talking about you and your classes because this is a different world. I'm talking generally about horsemanship in the world now, and the problem is that, for example, we use horses for sport. And no one knows if they like it or not. So, for example, we do jumping or dressage or other kinds of sports. Of course, there are obviously moments of complete abuse. And we are 100% sure that no one likes abuse. And this is very bad for horses. But if we look into it, that okay, horse is healthy, is moving very well, is enjoying the movement, is enjoying expressing himself through the movement, is doing all of these things, then we can start maybe assuming that maybe this horse enjoys this sport more than not doing it. You know, it's like, and other people try to reason about it, and they have different opinions. But even if you look at people and people's sport and how people are engaged into many things and how they push themselves through the limits, and other people cannot understand it, and they look into it and they say, no, this is bad, you shouldn't be doing it, for example. So you see, even that we can go to other person and ask, okay, you are a professional MMA fighter and people are beating you, you know, every week they are beating you, and you feel very bad after this, but you like it. And many people don't understand it, but for this person, it is something that it is really that this person likes. And then we look into the horse's situation, which we cannot come and ask, do you like it, you don't like it, and then people try to measure cortisol level or other stuff and reason on it, and they make some reasoning based on this, and they come to the conclusion that horses don't like sport, don't like sport, or this or that. So I wouldn't be going very deep into it because it depends on who believes in what.
I think that we are not touching like general situation. We have real life question. Mm. What are the tips that you could give to Anna now? Because she's asking about herself, not about general situation. I understood. Anna asks, is it about doing what is best for the horse and teach them how to handle him herself in different situations?
If it is your goal to do the best of the horse, then you are doing the best of the horse. From my perspective, setting such goals is very risky because you will be always asking yourself, what is best for my horse, what my horse wants, or what my horse needs. So this puts you in this situation that you are really not knowing how to act. Like this mother and the kid. Mother wants the best for the kid. This is obvious. But the kid says, I don't want to go to school. And what mother should do with it? Maybe I will not send my kid to school. And some mothers make such decision. I will not send my kid to school because my kid is unhappy at the school. You know? So is it a good decision? I don't know. Is it the best for the kid? I don't know. So you need to have a vision. You need to know what you want. If you are mother, you need to know what you want for your kid. If you are a horse owner, you need to know what you want for your horse. And I prefer to stay in the area. I want my horses to be healthy. I want my horses to be relaxed. I want my horses to be open, to be interacting with other horses and with humans in calmness. And then I believe, this is what I believe, and believe me, we are not the same person. Anna can believe in other things and can strongly disagree with me. But I believe that if you provide such things, your horse can do something to be happy. You know, like, let's leave this happiness to him and let's focus on the things that we can really do for him. Like with the kid.
Happiness we can also very much do.
As I said, Anna can disagree with me. And I don't want, personally, I wouldn't like my parents to be thinking constantly what would make me happy, because this would be crazy. I want them to be thinking about providing me these things that will allow me to be happy. And this is I personally think like this. I think personally that we can provide such things to the horses, and we can think ahead. We can think what can happen in their lives, and how we can make their lives better by providing them training, by providing them relaxation, by, you know, if the horse is relaxed, for example, can stay with other horses on the paddock. If not, he can stay alone. It is a very simple example, but it goes farther away. If the horse is relaxed, can the vets are coming and they taking care of this horse without putting him down for a moment, etc., etc., etc.
I think that what we are discussing can be very tricky because, you know, Pawel has his opinions, I have mine opinions. But I think personally that following desire to make your horse happy is like the best desire ever. This is something that has turned me into horse trainer and shaped my whole life with horses. I think that Pawel made here a beautiful point that it is not important to make your horse happy because you cannot know if you will be ever successful, but you can provide your horse tools to become happy. Mm-hmm. And I think that also having these tools, as Pawel described them, relaxation-based training, a lot of calmness, opens up a great channel of communication between you and your horse, and that your horse will be able to really tell you and not tell you in a way like, oh my God, the saddle, no, the girth is pinching. But your horse will be able to you will be able to guide your horse through these difficult situations in such a way that they are very easy, very based on relaxation. And both you and your horse will be able to see through them and see what is the possibility for them to bring for both of you there. And then we can make further decisions based on that. Not because many decisions, I see owners and horses are making many decisions based on avoidance, that you think that you search happiness, but in fact you are avoiding unpleasant situations or possible situations that are difficult, like for example, putting the bit in your mouth, in your horse's mouth and riding on the contact. So you think that you are in active search of happiness, but in fact you are in passive avoidance of some mm-hmm. situations. But if you enter these situations with a lot of relaxation, if you turn them into situations that are ruled by principles of relaxation, you and the horse can quickly see that these situations bring you a lot of happiness. And this is exactly our case with horses and the owners with our TRT training with the bit. Mm-hmm. And Sandra says, health is the base of a happy horse and owner.
Yes, you see, this is very typical because we've been talking about leadership and this topic is hard. And now we drifted to happiness or not happiness of the horses because this topic is easy. So let's talk about leadership again. What I wanted to say is that if you will be thinking too much about if my horse is happy or not happy, you will be not making decisions. You will be not making right decisions. You will be probably in this clinch of not knowing what to do. Do I want my horses to be happy? Yes. Am I driven? Is it driving me? Is it making me waking up every day and going there and doing training sessions with them?
Spending so much money.
Spending so much time. Yes. Like this mother. Does mother want kids to be happy? Yes. But when it comes to leadership, when you are putting your leader hat on your head, that you don't have to have all the time, but from time to time you need to do this, then you forget about such things. You forget about making your horse happy or yourself happy or other people happy. You only think about the situation and how to get the situation working and how to move from one place to another. When I'm hugging my horse and we spend times, you know, 5 minutes just being there and kissing one another, I'm not his leader then.
We do this, yes.
I'm not his leader then. We are just, family or whatever. But I also need to be a leader because when the vet comes and my horse is sick and I know that this vet is helpless and is just commenting the situation, I'm stepping up and I'm taking my phone, I'm calling for another vet, and I'm doing this. It happened two
weeks
ago.
You would have to see Pawel with the vets. He's making them cry and sweat. He's asking all the questions. Why are you giving this? How you support this decision? Is it justified? Tell me, explain to me. And they are like...
I'm not thinking about my people skills. I'm not apologizing him. I'm not asking him, will it be okay if I call another vet now? I'm not thinking about, is my horse happy with this? Is Anna happy with that? I'm not thinking about anything of this. I just have my goal. I want my horse to be healthy, and I will do anything to have it. And this is how you become a leader.
Okay, we have more questions, Pawel. Yes. So I think that we can, elaborate maybe more on that, supported with questions. Mm-hmm. So Anna says, meaning that you can challenge your horse to do things he would not do by himself. I am not trying to please my horse the whole time. Thank you, Anna. That was very clear for me. Yes, when the thing for me is like we enter with a horse new situation. I see that he's not happy about it. So I ask myself, okay, how can I make him happy? What skills is he lacking? Usually it's lack of relaxation. So we relax him inside of this context and it's like that. He becomes happy. He likes it. He wants to do it. Ivona says, I think Anna and Pawel has different definitions of happiness, which is absolutely okay and normal. I think that if you look deeper, if you dig deeper, our definitions are very, very shared. They are based on that happiness starts with relaxation.
Yes.
And that... we just express ourselves differently. And I think that thanks to that, we are having this, these two eyes when we look at the problems and the horses and the successes, that we complement one another so beautifully because we bring different qualities to the picture, and with having these both qualities, we have one horse life. We have all the classes that you so much enjoy because this is like a shared labor of me and of our joint philosophies, feels, emotions. Yara says, amazing webinar so far, had no idea what to expect in the beginning, was a bit tense, but over time I started to let go of tension, feeling more relaxed now. Now I know I am the wanderer, leader who does not know what I want, but actually during the meeting I learned that I know exactly what I want. I am just scared to get it, to work towards it. Any tips on how to let go of the fear and be more open to what you want without fear, to dare work more towards it without fear, and to become the best leader for my horse?
Yes. Can I ask that?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
It is a fantastic discovery that you make in your life that no one cares about you, really. And when we live our lives, we are thinking about some decisions, or I will do this, or I will do that. And then we immediately imagine all these people who will be maybe dissatisfied or even angry, or they will be disagreeing, or they will be this or that. Actually, they don't care. And this is what you learn, that if you are in the stable, or you are active on social media, or you have family involved with your horses, really they don't care what you will do with your horses. If you have trainers, if you have people who support you, they don't care what you will do with your horses. This is not good or bad, this is fact. And then there is another fact, that you need to be responsible and you need to know what to do. And this is not that you can decide about I will do this or not, but it is already decided for you. It is already decided for you that you are responsible for your horse. It is not something that you need to make this decision. It is already decided. When you bought your horse, it is already decided that you are responsible for your horse. And not the trainers which are training your horse, not the people around you, not your family, not people in your stable, but only you. And then when you combine these two things, you see that it already happened. it already happened that you are realizing your dream and no one cares about it, what you are doing with your horse. So you can do whatever you want. You don't have to be scared because no one will react to this. If you tomorrow you decide that you are riding your horse sitting, you know, looking to the back, or you are riding without saddles or standing on your horse, in the beginning people can look at you for 3 seconds and then they will be coming back and doing their job. And it is like this, because what we are fearing, what we are scared of, is really not existing. And if you want to check it now, ask yourself, do you care about how other people are training their horses? Do you even know it? If you are standing in the public stable, you can try to write down 3 persons and names of these horses and ask yourself what these people are really doing with these horses. And you will very quickly see that you don't know.
What are the requirements?
And because you don't care, and which is okay, because they are not your horses. And of course, we care about not going out of some limits, not that other people are not extremely abusive or aggressive, etc., etc. This is good. This is being part of society. But whether your friend is doing Western with this horse or dressage or is just going to the hacks, it's his decision. If your friend will call you today and say, I decided not to do dressage anymore, I will be hacking on my horses to the rest of your life, or his life, you will say, okay, hack with your horses, thank you, and see you tomorrow.
I think that, you know, Yara, to give you some practical advice now, I would say that don't look too far. Focus on 1 week ahead. What do you want to build in the upcoming week? Make a plan. Stick to this plan as much as you possible. Set a plan, but be flexible, but also stick like to the main like vision and goal behind this plan. Realize it week by week and you will see that achieving big goals is very simple, is very easy, is built of doing many, many little steps that you are not doing right now because you are, as you said, wandering around. Big, big dreams are built of small steps. And this is the secret. When you look at professional people that achieved a lot with their horses, you discover one thing. They are there with their horses almost every day, and the trainings take place. So this is the first step. The trainings must take place. If you are not taking your horse for trainings, if you are just coming to groom him, trim the hooves, cuddle him, then you will be good at that. You know, you are becoming good at what you do. So the first, if you want to achieve any like training results, the trainings have to take place. And this is the bottom line. So I have many, you know, we are guiding many professionals. Mm-hmm. And this is from what we start, you know, the trainings have to start taking place. You cannot just come and, you know, wander around, trim your horse, cut the tail, groom your horse, cuddle him, give him some carrots and hope that tomorrow will be better. The big, big achievements, you know, every big achievement is built of little steps. And to achieve this big achievement that maybe thinking of it even now makes you scared is actually composed out of many little steps. And just focus on them. Just focus on them. And you will see that they are easy. They are achievable. Make even, you know, plan before you go each day to the stable what you want to do and just do it. And you will see that in no time, your training skills will improve in a dramatic way. Mm-hmm. Then we have some nice comment from Christine Kern. It's like you are spotlights from 2 different sides shining in this to the same point. Yes, I really believe we are. Vicky says, love that big dreams come from small steps. Yes, this is how they are built. And Cindy says, fear sometimes come from the unknown, yet isn't this where you wish to be instead of in the pattern of automatic? Present moment is accepting at unknown. Absolutely, yes, Cindy, this is beautifully said. that unknown makes us scared, but if you you don't have to look, you know, in the perspective of 1 year forward, exactly as Sybil added right now, important message, what we do is what we will have. Yes, what you do every day is what you is where you will get. If you want to get in a different place, you have to start doing a little bit different things every day. Then Yara said, wish I could ride Asphalot, but he's a bit too small for that, being a Shetland pony and all. Thank you so much, Pawel, for your answer. I now realize I cared too much about what other people think of me and my way of being. That blocked me. And thank you so much, Anna. Yes, I will do that. I will really follow your tips and let you know how it goes. Wonderful. Mm-hmm. And then Yara adds, really appreciate and love both of your insights. Made me open up my eyes. Thank you so much to both of you. Thank you so much, guys. Let us know if you have any more questions. We should close soon so we can record this session and share with you. Katia says, this has been such an eye-opener of our webinar, Pawel. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I am very happy, and I invite you right now for joining me this Sunday at 7 p.m. for the SOS Anna. I will be taking a bite of the same cake, so we will be speaking also about effective leadership, but it will be from a different perspective. So we will be speaking from the perspective of SOS Anna. My leadership is absolutely ineffective. What to do? So I will lead you in another direction. Hope to see you soon. Sybil says, thank you. Look forward to hearing what I missed. Anki says, thank you, Pawel and Anna. Can you tell me what your current courses are, please? So it's best to start from the 14 days course in relaxation technique. Then you can do the relaxation of the stomach or optimal performance program, or both together. The best would be, then we suggest panic attacks if you have problems with that, and then residual tensions release course. And we are releasing this weekend new level courses which I will be loading to the trailer, riding movie and also the new energy course. So stay tuned, we have a lot of things prepared for you. Thank you both, thank you for your time. See you, Anna, can't wait. SOS, yes. Thank you, great webinar. I will be there on you on Sunday. Also wonderful. Thank you both for your amazing webinar. Will do my best to be here on Sunday. Janine says, thanks. As always, great meeting from which I have learned new things. Ivona says, dzięki and I do usłyszenia. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you, Pawel, for sharing your perspective.
Thank you, Anna.
Thank you to me for, as always, adding something. And I hope to see you all on Sunday for SOS Anna and next Friday for Open Course with Pawel. Thank you so much. See you soon.